I am very much indebted to the organizers of the Regina Peace Council. I'm delighted to be in Saskatchewan. There's one person I miss today, is my old friend David Orchard, who was not able to come due to a health problem. He called us up this morning, but David Orchard was very much instrumental, and that's when I met him, in the campaign against NATO military intervention in Yugoslavia, starting, of course, in 1999, but the crisis was before that. And he was so, his organizational skills, his focus, the way he managed to mobilize people from coast to coast, literally from coast to coast, it was absolutely remarkable. And I think it points to the fact that we need to rehabilitate that momentum that we had perhaps in the 90s or even up to the Iraq War. And the fact of the matter is that the anti-war movement has in large part been co-opted in the same way as the politicians have also been co-opted, but we know that. But the anti-war movement has been co-opted. The World Social Forum is funded by the Ford Foundation. And that perhaps also explains that today we're not a large crowd of people. The media does not cover war crimes unless they are committed by the victims of those war crimes. That's generally the focus. The victims of US-led wars are the protagonists of war crimes. Bashar al-Assad is killing his own people, quote unquote. But the fact of the matter is that the United States is waging a so-called counterterrorism operation in Iraq and Syria against ISIS Daesh, which happens to be a creation of US intelligence. So they send them in. It's a very diabolical project. You send in your intelligence assets into Mosul and Raqqa. They come in Toyota trucks with absolutely no air defense system whatsoever. They cross the desert from Syria into Iraq. It's open desert. If they had wanted to demolish the ISIS, it would have been a piece of cake in 20 minutes. The convoy, you saw those images of Toyota trucks crossing the desert. And then they occupy Mosul. The Iraqi military is co-opted and let it happen, and so on and so forth. That's one example. But we're dealing with a diabolical agenda where the United States is intervening under the banner of responsibility to protect or global war on terrorism. In other words, it is providing a legitimacy to a war of aggression or a sequence of wars of aggression. And the public is led to believe somehow that these are humanitarian undertakings. They're also led to believe that nuclear weapons are harmless to civilians, including what they call the more usable, low-yield nuclear weapons, more usable, intimating that these bombs are peace-making instruments. And now there's a $1.2 trillion nuclear weapons program, which enlarges an existing arsenal of more than 4,000 nuclear weapons, U.S. nuclear weapons, I'm not talking about other countries, which is enough to blow up the planet several times. I won't give you the number of times, but with a few bombs you can blow up the planet. And now these new tactical nuclear weapons, harmless to civilians, have an explosive capacity between one-third and 12 times a Hiroshima bomb. And bear in mind that during the first 7 seconds of the Hiroshima bomb, 100,000 people were killed. Now, let me put something into perspective. The title of my lecture tonight was called The Globalization of War, China, Russia, Iran, North Korea. Now that might seem to be a rather unusual title that I would list those four countries. I list those four countries because the United States is involved in World War III scenarios which go back at least 10 years. We're not privy to everything which has been done within the US military. But in 2007, the Pentagon had an exercise which was called Vigilance Shield. And it was, in effect, a scenario of a Third World War. And it was the United States of America against four fictitious countries, each of which were called Churia, China, Rubek, Russia, Birmingham, Iran, and Nemazi, North Korea. And this is a very detailed simulation of what would happen. Now, the fact of the matter is that those four countries are absolutely strategic for the following reason. They are non-compliant. They are exercising their sovereignty and they are refusing to abide by U.S. foreign policy. That's the only reason that the games were in relation to those four countries. But once you understand the strategic importance of those four countries, you get a better understanding of the logic behind this military agenda. It's a global military agenda. It is not a sequence of separate operations. It's very well coordinated. There's a roadmap. And that is understood. I could say that in the year 2000, prior to the inauguration George W. Bush, the project of the New American Century, which is a U.S. Washington-based think tank, published a report where they acknowledged a number of concepts. First, they said the United States will wage simultaneous, large-scale theater wars in different parts of the world. And this was put within a military framework. There was no justification to these wars. We will wage simultaneous theater wars in different parts of the world. And that was part of what they call the long war, okay? The long war against humanity, which is the subtitle of my book. But the term, the long war, is a Pentagon concept. So they, There was a roadmap, but bear in mind, the PNAC document says simultaneous, not consecutive. In fact, they've been doing both, but as you notice, they are threatening Iran on the one hand, and they're threatening North Korea on the other. They're threatening Russia, and they're threatening China. Okay? These are the strategic hot points, these four countries. Well, each of these pertain to different geographical regions. The Middle East, East, Northeast Asia, the South China Sea. Now, these are not the only areas where the U.S. military is actually involved. They're involved all over the world. They have their system of regional commands. But these four countries are considered strategic. In other words, they have to break them, so to speak, either through regime change or through military intervention or in some other way. Bear in mind, there's continuity in U.S. foreign policy right from the end of the Second World War. But to get back to the PNAC's concept of the long war, they have, one, the statement with regard to simultaneous theater wars, and then there's a statement which pertains to what they call constabulary functions. Now, constabulary functions doesn't mean necessarily theater wars, but it might mean sending in special forces, regime change, a whole series of interventions, intelligence ops, economic sanctions. But the constabulary functions were really formulated as a military concept of policing countries through military and non-military means. And then the third, which is included in this list, is the revolution in military affairs, which essentially means developing new capabilities in the production of weapon systems, of advanced weapon systems. And mind you, that was really largely in support of the U.S. military-industrial complex and the large corporate conglomerates which receive these multi-billion-dollar contracts from the Pentagon. So that is the background which currently prevails and which is important to understand what's going on in different parts of the world. And the war in Syria is very much linked to the next stage, which consists in threatening Iran. There is a roadmap. This was based on statements that General Wesley Clark made several years back, where a certain number of countries have been identified, Libya, Syria, Iraq, and so on. And now in the Middle East, of course, we have war. We have a war situation in Syria. We have a war situation in Iraq. We have Afghanistan. It's a renewed war. It's largely directed against the presence of China or Chinese business interests in Afghanistan. Then we had the war in Libya, again, also related to the fact that China was playing a major role in the petroleum industry. But in any event, this is a war without borders. It is a war of conquest. But to sell this to the public, you have to have quite a big army of media disinformation, propaganda, where you actually present war as a peacemaking undertaking. Okay, and anybody who contests that, of course, is a conspiracy theorist. So, but the logic, the explanations to justify this war inevitably are based on lies. You can't do it otherwise. We're not waging a war of conquest. We're waging a war with a view to restoring democracy. We are going after the terrorists who are threatening our way of life, and so on and so forth. The fact that those terrorists are sustained and supported and financed by the US military, by Saudi Arabia, by the Western alliance, is not something that you're going to read necessarily in the mainstream media. Although you have enough information in the mainstream media to connect the dots. Those terrorists are financed, trained, and they have Western military advisors embedded within, and of course they have the NGOs who are involved, as well as the media, in falsifying the truth. So what's happening in Syria today is certainly not a civil war. It is an insurrection whereby Al-Qaeda-affiliated entities, as well as ISIS, Daesh, are used as a means to destabilize and destroy a sovereign country. And this is not something which is acknowledged by the mainstream media. They will say Bashar al-Assad is killing his own people, the rebels are there, you know, and representing various religions, etc., within, well, essentially Sunni versus Shiite and Alawite. Of course, they never mentioned the fact that the cabinet of Bashar al-Assad is largely made up of Sunnis, and it just so happens his wife is a Sunni. Okay, does that mean he's going to go out and kill his wife? Okay, but you won't see this kind of logic. You won't. I spent 2 months in Syria before the war broke out, and it's a country of tremendous tolerance, religious tolerance. There was no sectarian conflicts whatsoever. There may have been political conflicts, but what the media describes is the clash of ethnic groups and religions and so on and so forth. But in large part, these clashes are engineered, and they're engineered by the Western powers, and the plans to intervene in Syria predate, of course, 2011, when the war broke out. Now, I think we have to also understand the broader implications, as well as the economic and social implications of this military agenda. I think we must understand, first of all, we are at the crossroads of perhaps the most serious crisis in modern history, or in world history, because the destructive capabilities are such that World War III is not an abstract concept. It is something which is absolutely real, but we will only find out how real it is when it happens. But the accumulation of advanced weapon systems, nuclear but also chemical, biological weapons, climatic warfare, these bona fide weapons of mass destruction have reached a point where, in fact, they could be used to destroy humanity and lead the world to the unthinkable. And there's so many scientific studies to that effect. It's based, if you look at, well, I just got a contribution this morning from Helen Caldicott, who is a well-known author. I've known her for years, and I asked her to write up a piece on what's happening in the military bases where they where they store the weapons to be deployed in the case of a nuclear war. And she had documented this at an earlier period, that many of these people are either drunk or they're on drugs, they're taking LSD, or that they're simply not at work, and so on and so forth. And in fact, this is documented from military sources. And bear in mind, it's very important, apart from the fact that Trump says, my button is bigger than yours, there's always the possibility of mistakes, technological mistakes, communications. And this we saw even during the Cuban Missile Crisis. Now, we all live in the world of wireless communication with internet and email and message systems, but we're all aware that this particular realm is characterized by glitches. I run a website, and I can tell you I have glitches very frequently, practically every day. Okay? Now imagine what a glitch would imply with regard to the usage of nuclear weapons. And there's another, those are technical mistakes. And then there are so-called political mistakes. And political mistakes, let me elaborate on that. Those who decide on the use of nuclear weapons are unaware of the consequences of their actions. Why? Because within the military, there is within the political apparatus, there is an internal process of propaganda, which is not intended for the broader public. It's called top officials. That's a military concept. And what the top officials at all very high levels of government, military, business, are led to believe is that you can win a nuclear war, one, and two, that those weapons are harmless to civilians because the explosion is underground. I'm quoting from the Pentagon. And now it's a little bit like relabeling a pack of cigarettes. The more usable tactical nuclear weapon, low yield, 1/3 to 12 times a Hiroshima bomb, is, quote, harmless to civilians because the explosion is underground. These are bunker buster bombs, but how many feet underground do they actually go? I checked the data. It's the size of this building. Of course, the rubble comes up, and they don't even talk about radioactive fallout anymore. Okay? They don't talk about it. And so that propaganda is intended for people who take decisions. And now, does Mad Dog Mattis know what the impact of nuclear weapons is? It's a bit of harakiri, because taking that decision ultimately also kills U.S. foreign policy and the U.S. elites, and not to mention the corporations which are recipients of $1.2 trillion defense contracts to develop new nuclear weapons. They'll never be able to cash in on their profits unless they do it before. I'm being a bit cryptic, but the thing is that it's a diabolic agenda. It's based on lies, and then the lie becomes the truth, okay? And when the lie becomes the truth, there's no moving backwards. And that is what is happening. The lie becomes the truth. Peace, war becomes peace, and peace becomes, what we understand as peace is a conspiracy theory, okay? So that in that sense, we are living in what I'd call an inquisitorial environment. because it's not so much even the question of obfuscating the lies. It is heralding the lie as truth, unquestionable truth, a bit like the witches during the Spanish Inquisition, okay? Or the French Inquisition was even worse. But that's another matter. But we look back at that, and this, how is it they didn't understand, the logic behind this? But again, it's a very similar logic to what prevails today. And then we have terrorists coming in, attacking Western cities. Now, it just so happens that all those terrorists happen to be on the radar of the police and the intelligence. Then they find the passports somewhere, on the road or in the car or in the rubble. And then not a single one of these terrorists actually survives. They're suspects. They get shot dead. There's never any investigation. And then, referring to the Brussels attacks, it just so happens that the footage of the video passed when they attacked the airport, that was a couple of years back. What footage did they take? Moscow Airport. They didn't have the footage for what really happened there. So they play around with the images. Now, nobody will dispute that. We've published that. Those are fake images and fake videos. But in the case of Brussels, what was quite striking is that in the morning, there was an attack at the airport. You remember those events. There's an attack at the airport, and then it was broadcast on the news, and they used the footage of Moscow Airport. I happen to know that airport. And then in the afternoon, there was an attack in the metro station, and they took the metro station of Minsk, Belarus, which happened a few years earlier. So in other words, there was never any questioning. How is it? I can understand that there may be one fake video in the morning, but that both videos were fake, okay? You have a whole series of contradictions. During the Paris attacks, the Bataclan and the Jewish grocery store. One of the suspects who was shot dead a couple of years earlier had a one-to-one meeting with the French president at the Élysée Palace. Now, it wasn't one-to-one, but he was there and he met the president. Now, I'm not saying necessarily that this indicates any kind of, relationship, but it was not investigated by any French reporter. What the hell was this suspect who was a dropout living in a slum area in the periphery of Paris? How is it that he was received at the Élysée Palace 2 years earlier? Okay, because so the whole process of investigative reporting was shunted in the coverage of those events. Why is it that all the suspects are killed, even those who then they say, oh, we made a mistake, we've killed him, but he didn't do it, okay? So that's the logic. We have these events which are there to intimidate the population, and then of course and to endorse the narrative, the underlying narrative of the war on terrorism. Okay, they have to believe it, and for them to believe it, there have to be events in their daily lives. People have to be intimidated, and that's what's happening. They're intimidated, and they see, of course, Muslims as enemies of the state and so on. And then of course there's a vast campaign of Islamophobia. And then you ask yourself, why? Well, the answer is quite simple, but almost 70% of oil and natural gas happens to lie, I'm talking about the reserves, I'm talking not talking about tar sands, happens to lie in Muslim countries. And the area from, let's say, the tip of Saudi Arabia up to the Caspian Sea Basin, largely Muslim countries, is more than 60% of the global reserves of crude oil. Now, if those lands had been inhabited by Buddhists, we would be involved in a campaign against the Buddhists, obviously. You know, we're going after the Muslims because they happen to own the oil. Now, I was made a presentation at in Montreal, organized by Concordia University, and I mentioned that was a few years ago, and I said that according to U.S. Central Command documents, there was a plan, and that dates back to 95, first Iraq, then Iran, and then they put as a justification to ensure the supply of oil to Western markets. Okay, but the solution to ensuring the supply of oil to Western markets was to wage war on these two countries, and it was very clearly stated in this document. And then somebody says, "Professor, but we need that oil." I said, "What's the solution?" I said, "Well, buy it, don't steal it." But that's what they're doing. They're stealing it. They're going into Iraq. They knock down the country, and then what's? And then, of course, you go in and take over the oil. The country is so indebted that they will exchange the oil for all the debts which have been also accumulated as a result of the war. So that is the background. We are in a world. Sorry, I'm facing a glitch here on my computer. We are in a situation where people who decide are actually war criminals. Okay, Obama is a war criminal. By now, I think Trump is also a war criminal. Okay, if you bomb a country illegally and kill civilians, you're a war criminal. If you impose a naval embargo on food and medicine, which is triggering at least a million people starving in Yemen, that's a war crime. And that's quite deliberate. There's the danger of a million people dying in Yemen because there is a naval blockade where the U.S. Navy is there. They're not letting any ships in, so that the country is cut off from the rest of the world, doesn't get medicine, doesn't get food, and is involved in and is the subject of, I would say, U.S.-led bombings implemented by one of its proxies, Saudi Arabia and the Emirates. But U.S. advisors all over the place, and of course, special forces, Green Berets, are in Yemen. Okay? Now, we are led by war criminals. And I'm using the international definition of war crimes. And we also have a media which is complicit in this agenda, which is also responsible for war crimes. War propaganda is an illegal act under Nuremberg. And if we look at the timeline in the post 9/11 era, I think it's very clear, of course, that the 9/11 attacks were absolutely fundamental in setting the stage, well, first of all, setting the stage for the global war on terrorism. What happened? And that's where the media comes in, because they fail to underscore the political lies. At 11 o'clock in the morning, George Tenet, That's on the morning of 9/11. George Tenet states Al-Qaeda's behind it. Where did he have the evidence? There was no investigation which had been carried out. Two hours later, at 11 in the morning, I checked the news. George Tenet says, yes, Al-Qaeda's behind it. And then at 9 in the evening, they declare war on Afghanistan. And the following day, NATO, invoking Article 5 of the Washington Agreement, of their articles, etc., declares war on Afghanistan. Well, in fact, it was confirmed at a later date, but nonetheless, they say one member of NATO is attacked under the doctrine of collective security. All members of NATO have been attacked. That was the justification. Now, nobody knew about that. They didn't really understand the logic. Afghanistan was identified as a state sponsor of terrorism. Al-Qaeda was responsible. And then the day after, in Brussels, they invoke Article 5, and they say, we are now at war with Afghanistan. And then on the 7th of October, they invade Afghanistan. That's less than a month, okay? Now, there's several lies in that narrative. One, there was no proof it was Al-Qaeda. Apart from the fact that Osama bin Laden was in a hospital bed in Rawalpindi, a military hospital under the auspices of the Pakistani military, he had a kidney problem, and he was admitted on the 10th. Now, was he actually, I'm being facetious, was he coordinating the 9/11 attacks from his handheld, in the hospital? And he was then, and then Rumsfeld said, we don't know where he is. It's like looking for a needle in the stack of hay. And in fact, they knew all along where he was, okay? And with modern technology, all you have to do is to slash a few, pieces of metal into his body, and you can use your GPS to go after him. Those technologies were available in 2001. But again, a whole series of lies. Now, the other big lie, when the war broke out in Afghanistan, is you cannot, under any circumstances, prepare a major theater war thousands of miles away in 28 days. Impossible. Okay? A war of that magnitude takes months and months and months, and sometimes years to prepare. But there wasn't a single military analyst who actually had the courage of saying, well, how come they managed to do that so quickly after 9/11 and have it, have the Air Force there going in? Ed took several months to prepare this meeting, right? Okay. How many months has it taken to prepare this meeting? Can you imagine a war run by the Pentagon with all its complexities, and they do it in 28 days? So that is where I think that is where the perceptions of the public start to evolve. And that's where 9/11 truth and 9/11 lies play a crucial role. People are led to believe that they are threatened by terrorists, Islamic terrorists. There's a process of intimidation which takes place. The military concept behind that is called the massive casualty producing event. And it's a military concept. And it says the following: if you want to mobilize people's concerns and so on, you have to have dead people. You have to have casualties. And a massive casualty producing event has the effect of creating, quote, a useful wave of indignation. I'm quoting a Pentagon document. It's from Operations Northwards, which was a secret plan to have a false flag in relation to Cuba, killing people in the Miami Cuban community, and then there would be a useful wave of indignation. You can check that document. But the useful wave of indignation after 9/11, well, I wouldn't necessarily use that term in relation to 9/11, but nonetheless, without 9/11, they wouldn't have had the pretext and the justification to invade Afghanistan. But there were no people didn't reflect, first of all, another element, and that's where the lies, the media lies come in. In the course of the month of September, the Afghan government, the so-called Taliban, which incidentally, George W. Bush, when he was during his election campaign, he says, the Taliban, I thought that was a rock group. You can see how well informed he is. He said, oh, I thought that was a rock group. He also said, incidentally, when a Canadian journalist interviewed him during his election campaign, he said, Governor Bush, what do you think about Canadian Prime Minister Jean Poutine's trade proposal? Okay? And he said, tell Prime Minister Poutine I fully support him. Okay. Poutine is, apart from the fact that it's the surname of the Russian Prime Minister, it is also some very obnoxious dish which people in Quebec absolutely adore. It's sort of French fries with cheese on top and then gravy. I don't suggest that you eat that, but... But in any event, that was broadcast. But you can just see the level, the intellectual, the level of knowledge of these people, and these people have the power to press the button. Okay, they have the power to press the button, they are very unaware of the actions of the consequence of their actions now. I'm getting back to September 2001. The Taliban government actually approached the U.S. State Department twice and said, if you provide us some preliminary evidence concerning Osama bin Laden, we are prepared to deliver him to the U.S. justice system. Okay? So there is the number one terrorist who was the object of a whole series of, the saga went on. But of course, if you arrest the number one terrorist, you're left with a hole in your narrative. There can't be a global war against terrorism if you've arrested Osama bin Laden. Okay? So that was made on two occasions through diplomatic channels. It's a government. And they said, if you want us to deliver him, we will do it. And then George W. Bush said, we don't negotiate with terrorists. Okay, so it was a bit a non sequitur, circular type of thing. But the fact of the matter is that war was instigated with very little opposition. People were so shocked by what happened on the September 11, they didn't want to even express their critique and say, well, Afghanistan didn't attack America. We didn't see any jet fighters in the street, in the skies of New York with Afghani flag there. No, we didn't. What's the proof? Tell us. And that would have been a normal response to the statements made at the Atlantic Council on September 12. Where they said, no, we're going to invade Afghanistan because Afghanistan has attacked a member state of the Atlantic Alliance. That was the discourse. And we were misinformed because none of this actually was reported in any meaningful way by the corporate media. Now, In that regard, I think the 9/11 events played the role of a watershed. It signified the inauguration of the global war on terrorism. It provided a justification for subsequent wars, although the 2003 invasion of Afghanistan had a somewhat different logic, because we did have a very significant anti-war protest movement. But despite the protest movement, they went ahead. Now, let me give you another big lie about, which was not covered. We've covered it, and nobody really knows about it. There was a lot of discussion on what was called the Downing Street memos, okay? I won't go back on the Downing Street memos, but there was something far more serious, and it had to do with Colin Powell's presentation to the United Nations in early February 2001. And for people who recall that, Colin Powell came in and said, "This is a very authoritative report by British intelligence, blah, blah, blah." Okay? And he said, "Weapons of mass destruction," and then he quoted from the report, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And British intelligence provided us with this report, and that was the basis upon which the war on Iraq was justified. And there was very little questioning of where this intelligence report came from, although we knew, because a professor at Cambridge, Glenn Rangwala, read the report and he said, "It looks familiar." And he started then looking at the quotations and discovered that the report had been copied and pasted off the internet. It was plagiarized. And he managed, and he proved it. It was an incredible achievement, because there were certain even typos he went back to the original sources, and in fact they copied it from a PhD document which was being presented in California. And so that report was aired on Channel 4. A Guardian, I think, did publish excerpts. I was in touch with him. We published the whole document. Then, but it was not used as a means to question the legitimacy of Colin Powell's lies, statements at the United Nations Security Council. Okay? Nobody stood up, came up and said, "Well, according to Glenn Rangwala, you plagiarized. That report is, and that report wasn't prepared by British intelligence. It was prepared by public relations offices in the office of Tony Blair." Okay? Now, that was one element of the war in Iraq, which very few people know about, because essentially it wasn't covered. Okay? Simply wasn't covered. Another thing which wasn't covered about the 9/11 attacks was the fact that it was a third tower that came down. We didn't know, even people who were consistently involved in research. I was doing research on 9/11. It was several years later that we found out that Tower 7 had collapsed. And then we then took cognizance of the fact that the announcement of Tower 7 was made on CNN and BBC about 20 minutes before the event actually happened. And then there was no investigation of how is it that there was foreknowledge of this building going to collapse which wasn't even struck by an aircraft. Okay, there was some little bit of fire here and there, but it was brought down through controlled demolition. That is absolutely corroborated. So there we have a whole series of inconsistencies, which ultimately point to extensive war propaganda and manipulation, not only omissions, but absolute lies and fabrications. There was never a police investigation into the 9/11 attacks. There was never any investigation as to why this Building 7, which was not struck by an airplane, and came down after the BBC had actually announced it, because we saw the BBC journalist was there, and she had the Tower 7 was in the background, and then it happened 20 minutes later. And that information was totally suppressed, okay? Totally suppressed. So, where was I? The global war on terrorism is fake. Al-Qaeda is a US intelligence construct. We're presenting war as a responsibility to protect and a GWAT. That's the global war on terrorism. And then, of course, we have the doctrine of preemptive warfare. Now, preemptive warfare was developed in 2001, and it was the Nuclear Posture Review, and it pertained precisely to these tactical nuclear weapons. But the notion of preemptive nuclear war is that you use nuclear weapons to defend yourself, and you actually go and bomb a country with nuclear weapons as a means to defending yourself, even if that country doesn't even have nuclear weapons. And I can tell you that Libya was one of the first countries to be which had been, according to Pentagon documents, they had envisaged using tactical B-61 bombs with nuclear warheads against Libya. The project was abandoned, but it was announced by the Pentagon. That was during the Clinton administration. Okay, and again, then you had the preemptive nuclear war, which says, and preemptive war in general. Okay, you attack a country to prevent it from attacking you. Okay, but of course, America is situated several thousand miles from where that country happens to be. So this doctrine becomes embedded in U.S. foreign policy. But I should also mention that if we start doing a little bit of background history, the doctrine that we're experiencing in the post 9/11 period has its roots essentially in the early years after World War II. The first nuclear weapon was dropped on Hiroshima on August 6, 1945. And Harry Truman made the statement on August 9th, when the second bomb was dropped. It was a long speech. He was coming back from the Potsdam conference in Germany, but he said, I quote, "The world will note that the first atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, a military base, and that was because we wanted to save the lives of innocent civilians," unquote. Now, that doctrine of collateral damage has been persistent, but in fact, what we notice in U.S. military doctrine, even going back to the later period, the last year of World War II, where you had these massive use of firebombs and the bombings of German cities, they were civilian targets exclusively. Okay, and the same thing in Japan. exclusively civilian targets. And then that doctrine ultimately then prevailed in the early 50s when you had the Korean War, the massive casualties which occurred from 1950 to 53, where 30% of the population of North Korea was killed. Now, from their standpoint, the United States is a threat to their national security. Of course, Americans presented the other way around. North Korea is a threat to our security. Well, we happen to have killed 30% of its population, okay? That's about the size of California. No, that would be 20%, 60 million people out of more than 300 million. But bear in mind, the U.S. military actually acknowledges, because if you look at a quotation of General Curtis LeMay, who says, we must have killed what? In the course of 18 months of bombing, what? 20% of the population and the totality of the cities, 98% of the cities. The crimes committed to in relation to the Korean people there's no other precedent in history, okay? If you look at World War II, the countries which lost the largest share of their population were Soviet Union, Germany, and Yugoslavia, primarily, those three countries. But we're not talking about, as far as Russia was, Soviet Union is concerned, it was about 10% of the population. But there we're talking about 30% of the population. And then, of course, today, when we discuss denuclearization, we fail to understand what this country went through and what it went through in the aftermath of the Korean War, where every single year it is threatened by nuclear weapons. Every single year since 1950. I should also mention another thing, is that already in 1945, the United States had formulated a plan to bomb. That was when the United States and the Soviet Union were allies on the 15th of September 1945, barely a few weeks after the end of World War II. They released, it's a declassified document, they had a plan to bomb 204 cities across the Soviet Union. And that plan was formulated in 1942. It wasn't formulated during the Cold War. It was first formulated in 1942. It was released in 1945. And then they had another set of plans which go to the 60s, but then we're in the Cold War era. That's another matter. I don't want to get into it. But the thing is that the nuclear doctrine, which emerges, goes back to Truman and the so-called Truman Doctrine. But now, if you look at, because next week, of course, it's the summit in Singapore. I'm leaving, incidentally, after this event, I'm off to South Korea, okay? Precisely for events which are held in relation to that summit they're different venues, but one is in the South Korean parliament, where they at least have the courtesy of inviting a conspiracy theorist. But what I'd like to say, to put this thing in perspective, North Korea has about 10 nuclear bombs. I haven't looked at the most recent data. It might be more than that. Okay, the United States at 4,000. But Belgium has five times more nuclear weapons than North Korea. There's a whole series of European countries. We never mention them. They have nuclear weapons, okay? They have nuclear weapons. And I'm talking about Belgium, Holland, Germany, Italy, and Turkey. Turkey has 90, I think, no, now they're less, about 50, okay? But I mean, I have the figures on this. In other words, and it's amply documented. Yes, Belgium had 20, at least double what North Korea has. They have B-61-11 tactical nuclear weapons. So there you have five non-nuclear, so-called non-nuclear states, which have nuclear weapons made in America under national command. That means that under international law, they are nuclear weapons states, even if they don't produce the nuclear weapons. Now you have the situation of Germany. Now Germany is a nuclear weapons state as well. A, it has under national command tactical nuclear weapons, B-61, and at the same time, through its partnership with Aerospatiale Matra, and which ultimately then, and Deutsche Aerospace, which ultimately then merges into a new company called EADES, European Air Defense System Corporation, Germany produces nuclear weapons for the French Navy. Okay, that's all right. So the French are the official nuclear weapon state, but the weapons, the nuclear bombs are produced in a binational partnership, but which it's a Franco-German company. Okay, but nobody points their finger at Germany or Italy or Belgium or the Netherlands, not to mention Israel, which has some 400 nuclear weapons. Okay, and Japan most probably has nuclear weapons capabilities. So there we are, a small country in Northeast Asia, which chose to develop nuclear weapons after having been threatened with nuclear war for more than half a century, because that came rather late. They are now pinpointed. They are, incidentally, North Korea is the only nuclear weapons state that voted in favor of the motion of the United Nations General Assembly presented by the International Campaign Against Nuclear Weapons. They voted in favor of that campaign. The media will never even mention it. And the countries that voted, there were several countries abstained, including China, India, and Pakistan. They abstained. And the rest of the gang, including Russia, voted against. But North Korea, that was their policy, is they are against nuclear weapons, but they have developed nuclear weapons as a means of deterrence. Now, what I don't think much is going to come of this agreement, of this summit next week. There will be, of course, a show, but I don't think that the North Koreans will actually accept to denuclearize without receiving something in exchange. Now, there's a tremendous dichotomy or imbalance, because you have 4,000 nuclear weapons plus $1.2 trillion allocated to nuclear weapons on the one hand, and then you have a country which has about 10 nuclear bombs with limited delivery capabilities. But again, the real threat to global security is the United States of America, particularly in view of this, the fact that it is spending billions and billions of taxpayers' money for the development of its weapons arsenal. Now, let me conclude and maybe raise some of the economic and social dimensions, how this war economy ultimately, how this war economy leads to certain restructuring of the global economy. The two most dynamic sectors, and we're living under a neoliberal agenda, the two most dynamic economic sectors of the global economy, guess what? Weapons production on the one hand, and luxury goods on the other. Luxury goods, including entertainment, hotels, travel and leisure, infrastructure, and so on and so forth, which is geared to an upper income market. Why? Because the New World Order is characterized by extensive austerity measures, neoliberal phasing out of social programs, which are there essentially also to free the funds which finance the war economy. Okay, you can't spend $1.2 trillion on nuclear weapons and then at the same time finance your health services. Okay, so that there is a fiscal structure underlying this. So the weapons industry is very, very prosperous. It's doing very well. And then it creates also corporate lobby groups, which are pushing, of course, to get these contracts. I'm convinced that Lockheed Martin doesn't necessarily want to blow up the planet. They're not interested in that. They're interested in getting the money. Now, if you had a government which were committed to peace, they would then say, okay, Lockheed Martin, we will fund your civilian aircraft. But in fact, they're doing exactly the opposite. Boeing has lost its contracts with Iran, delivery of civilian aircraft. But that doesn't matter because Boeing is also producing jet fighters and missiles and so on. And the whole process underlying nuclear weapons has been privatized. I don't have time to get into that. It goes back to a secret meeting which was held at Strategic Command headquarters in 2003, I believe, where the private sector was invited in and they established the doctrine for the expansion of the nuclear weapons industry. But again, to get back to the economic and social dimensions, we are living the most serious economic crisis in world history, where vast sectors of the population are driven into beyond poverty, into total despair. And this is not due to a lack of resources by any means. It is essentially due to the fact that you have a process of economic expansion, which is ultimately strictly based on profit, which destroys the environment. If we look at farming, it's the whole issue of the genetically modified seeds. It's the reproduction of the agricultural cycle. The agricultural cycle is dead in many countries. And when you don't reproduce food, or when the reproduction of food depends on the authority of Bayer Monsanto, where farmers can't reproduce their seeds, there is a very serious problem. And that is tied into the military agenda. There are many examples of this happening around the world. India, where you see Indian farmers committing suicide. Ethiopia, the whole structure of biodiversity has been destroyed as a result of the influx of genetically modified seeds. And that happened after a U.S. engineered war. Okay? So all these things, in essence, are interconnected. And I think it points, again, to the need to have a very broad-based mass movements. It's not a simple matter. And and maybe we can discuss it later on, but David is going to focus on that. But we need desperately to rebuild a mass movement which is not dependent on corporate financing, which is the norm today, okay? And I'm on the blacklist of the World Social Forum. And then I was at a conference in Brazil, which was on the invitation of the landless farmers, okay? And then we were discussing the World Social Forum, and I said, you can't expect to be able to take on a progressive stance against the Rockefellers when the Rockefellers are paying for your expenses, okay? But I mean, that's true. You look at who's funding all these NGOs. It's Soros, it's Rockefeller, it's the MacArthur Foundation, it's the NED, and so on. So obviously, you can't, if you say, well, I'm against US support for Al-Qaeda, they cut your money off immediately, okay? So there's a whole load of people there, of leftist progressives, getting money from foundations, and that in itself is a means to, in fact, destroying the mass movement altogether. We let them protest, but within certain norms and certain realms. We have progressive intellectuals, but many of those progressive intellectuals are supportive of U.S. foreign policy. And that is something which is absolutely fundamental if we want to rebuild an anti-war movement in Canada. We have to start, we have to be independent, we have to be sovereign, and we are not taking the money from corporations or governments, because that would tie us down. Thank you very much.